Hachette Audio presents The Habsburgs, written by Martyn Rady, read by Simon Boughey.
A note on names. All names of places are given by reference to their current names in use. The exception is Budapest, where Buda and Pest are used separately up until 1873, when the two cities merged. The names of people follow no consistent scheme. Generally, the names given are the ones most often used in the current historical literature, so Archduke Ludwig, but Archduke John. Where there is no consensus, names have been anglicized. The German F ending in proper names has generally been rendered PH. Introduction. An Emperor's Library. The Hofburg was the winter palace of the Habsburgs and is now Vienna's main tourist attraction. Horse-drawn carriages take sightseers through its arches and along the narrow streets of the neighboring old city. Crowds press through tight alleys, spilling carelessly into the traffic when they spot the white noses of the Lipizzaner horses in their stables. Apart from the green-domed St. Michael's Wing, built in the 19th century, the palace exterior is unimpressive, comprising consecutive courtyards, now used as car parks, with surrounding facades in a generally subdued Baroque style. At least today's Hofburg is in good repair. Photographs and lantern slides from the time before 1918, when it was still a working palace, show fallen masonry, cracked walls, and broken windows. For much of its history, the Hofburg has been a building site. Successive emperors added on wings, tore down obstacles to improvement, and rebuilt in stone rather than wood. Until the late 17th century, the Hofburg was also integral to the city's defences and rested against one of Vienna's bastioned walls. The Ottoman Turks last set siege to the city in 1683. With their defeat, it was finally possible for Habsburg emperors to conceive of the Hofburg as a palace and ceremonial stage and not as a fortified residence. At the heart of the Hofburg is a so-called Old Fort, Alte Burg. The reconstruction of the palace in the late 17th and 18th centuries has built over it so that little trace of the original fabric of the old fort is visible today. Put up in the first half of the 13th century, the old fort was a massive stone keep, 50 metres, 160 feet square, with four towers each topped with high gable roofs and finials. Despite its size, the interior of the old fort was bleak. Visitors complained of the courtyard within, which was insufficiently broad for a cart to turn, of the cramped chambers, mouldy staircases, and lack of tapestries on the walls. But the purpose of the Hofburg's old fort was not to impress by the luxury of its accommodation. It was intended to overawe the city and countryside beyond, and to communicate a message of power. The old fort became the first Habsburg emblem. In origin, the Habsburgs were a central European dynasty, and Austria was their heartland. But in the 16th and 17th centuries, they were also rulers of Spain and of Spain's possessions in the Low Countries, Italy, and the New World. Although by then militarily obsolete, the design of the old fort was reproduced in the great castles that the Habsburgs either commissioned or rebuilt in Spain, in Toledo and Madrid, and it was carried to the Americas. In Mexico, the blockhouse with four towers was a mark of the power wielded by the first royal governors. Lesser men had to be content with just two towers. In the Holy Roman Empire, over which the Habsburgs ruled as emperors, and which is very roughly where Austria, Germany, and the Czech Republic are today, ambitious princes also built four-tower keeps as a way of communicating their own prestige. The Habsburgs were the first rulers whose power encompassed the world, and they achieved greatness by luck and by force. The four-tower keep was in the 16th century an expression of their physical mastery of a part of Europe, and by its reproduction overseas, evidence of their global dominion. but it was only one symbol among many that the Habsburgs deployed. For they conceived of their power as both something that they had been predestined for and part of the divine order in which the world was arranged. This required a subtler symbolism than a threat in stone. The rebuilding of the Hofburg in the early 18th century, which saw the old fort finally disappear from the horizon, included the construction of the court library, Hofbibliothek. Previously, the imperial library had been housed in an abandoned friary in Vienna, in the wing of a private palace, and in a wooden structure in the shadow of the old fort on today's Josefsplatz. The librarians complained of the damp, the dust from the street, the inadequate lighting, and the fire hazard. But it was only during the long reign of Charles VI, 1711 to 1740, that the Imperial Library found a permanent home on a space immediately south of what had been the old fort. The new library building was put up in the 1720s, and it remains much the same today as Emperor Charles VI intended. Some 200,000 books and manuscripts were shelved in a single hall, 75 metres, 250 feet long. By this time, the collection included works on theology, church history, law, philosophy, science and mathematics, and bound manuscripts written in Greek, Latin, Syriac, Armenian and Coptic. Charles opened his library to scholars, although they had to apply for permission, and visiting hours were restricted to mornings. In return for this act of generosity, Charles imposed a tax on newspapers. Originally temporary, to cover the cost of building, the tax soon became permanent, being ostensibly dedicated to future acquisitions. Printers were also expected to furnish the library with copies of every book they produced. Since many Viennese printers also dealt in pornography, this was an obligation that was often shirked. In the centre of the library stands a life-size marble statue of Charles VI, portrayed as Hercules of the Muses. The dome ceiling above depicts his apotheosis or elevation to the heavens and celebrates his achievements with allegorical figures. Unlike George Washington, whose apotheosis is shown on the rotunda of the United States Capitol building, no portrait of Emperor Charles stares down at us from the ceiling. Charles was still alive when the artist began work, and so not yet received in heavenly glory. But a floating figure bearing a laurel crown waits for him, leaving us in no doubt that Charles will, at his life's end, be received in the company of angels and will sit among them in the clouds. The marble statue of Charles VI was joined on the floor of the library by 16 statues of Habsburg emperors, kings and archdukes, starting with the 13th century King Rudolf and finishing with Charles II of Spain, who died in 1700. Marble statues are expensive items to commission, so most were taken from the Hofburg storerooms and gardens. Over time, they were added to and swapped with statues in other imperial palaces. The earliest historian of the court library was critical of the original selection, for he considered too many of the 16 statues to recall Habsburg rulers who had shown no special interest in study or learning. Clearly, he imagined that a library should have something to do with books and scholarship. But this was a court library, and its purpose was different: to make a statement about the Habsburgs and their place in the divine ordering of the universe. The entire decoration of the library, including its ceiling, wall frescoes and furniture, speaks to the greatness of the Habsburgs and to their limitless power. So the four large globes of the earth and heavens that stand beneath the central cupola are metaphors for the reach of Habsburg ambition. Each bookcase is flanked by double pillars, and the motif of the twin pillars is evident throughout the library's construction, most notably in the white marble and gilt columns at each end of the hall, as well as on the building's exterior facade. They stand for the pillars of Hercules and the Habsburg watchword still further, and thus for a dominion that was unconstrained by physical geography. Above, in the fresco of the apotheosis, are three classical goddesses who bear a banner on which is written A-E-I-O-U. The acrostic can stand for many things, and scholars have suggested that there may be as many as 300 different solutions and combinations. But all of them point to the greatness of the Habsburgs of Austria. Hence, in the acrostic's most common reading, Austria is to rule the world. In Latin, Austria est imperia orbi universae. Or in German, alles Erdreich ist Österreich untertan. This was not, however, a vision of worldly dominion, rooted in the exercise of political power and in physical coercion. Charles poses in his library as the patron of the sciences and arts, not as a warrior bent on conquest. The apotheosis celebrates Charles's virtues, his magnanimity.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.